The next item of business is a Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee debate on the road to COP27 and beyond, tackling the climate emergency in the aftermath of COP26. And may I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Dean Lockhart to speak on behalf of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This is not your typical committee debate where there is a committee report to read and comment on. Instead, the committee decided to use our time to reflect on the significant progress made at COP26 in Glasgow and, more importantly perhaps, to assess what progress is being made against climate change targets here in Scotland. My comments today largely reflect the evidence the committee has heard over the past 6 months in relation to our inquiry on the role of local government in delivering net zero targets. We decided to conduct this inquiry because local authorities are one of the most important frontline delivery partners in this area. And at this stage, let me thank the clerks to the committee and SPICE for the first-class support and for arranging a number of excellent witness sessions. Presiding Officer, at the conclusion of COP26, Senator John Kerry said the following: "As we leave Glasgow, the fundamental issue is going to be implementation, delivery and follow-through on policy commitments." With this in mind, I want to highlight three of the biggest delivery challenges we face in Scotland. And in doing so, I would remind the Chamber that the most important role that committees have in this Parliament is to critically scrutinise government policy, highlight where it may not be delivering, and ideally provide suggested answers. The first thing I want to address is the decarbonisation of heat, which I think is going to be one of the most difficult policies to deliver. The challenge is enormous. To retrofit and install new heating systems in 1 million domestic dwellings and up to 50,000 business premises by 2030, with an estimated cost of £33 billion, with the vast majority of this funding to come from the private sector, all of which has to be delivered within the next 8 years. But if you take a closer look at this 8-year timeframe, the reality is that the sheer scale of the physical work required means that the work will need to start by 2025 at its latest. In other words, it will take at least 5 years, if not longer, to retrofit and decarbonise 1 million homes. That's 200,000 conversions a year. And just by way of context, the current rate of installation of heat pumps in Scotland is 2,500 a year, according to SPICE. So there's obviously quite a bit to go. But before this physical work can begin, the required financing will have to be in place. Projects can't start until there is guaranteed financing in place. Presiding Officer, all this effectively means is that the Scottish Government has only 2 or 3 years before 2025 to coordinate and arrange the bulk of the necessary financing. And we're looking at somewhere in the region of between £10 and £15 billion. And that's only half of the overall estimated costs. This will clearly be a massive challenge, because if we are asking the private sector to invest £10 to £15 billion, a huge amount of preparation needs to start now. First of all, investors will need comprehensive data on the housing stock that is being financed, its valuation, physical condition, historical rental income, historical rates of rental delinquency, and most likely a rating from one of the rating agencies. But it appears that not a lot of work is currently being done in this area. For example, Patrick Harvey, the Minister in charge of the Heat and Buildings Policy, replied to my parliamentary question by saying the breakdown of numbers of dwellings that will require upgrades in different periods and across different tenures is not currently available. And in giving evidence to the committee, the Phoenix Group, one of the largest potential private investment funds in this area, told us that, I quote, "there is a lack of comparable data, which is a big challenge." Then there is the challenge of scale. Local authorities will need to combine their housing stock assets in order to meet the scale of investment required by private investors. Susan Aitken, head of Glasgow City Council, told us, and I quote, "in terms of financing, we need to be able to engage with the private sector at a level and scale that has never been done before in local government. Local authorities in Scotland are not able to offer that on their own." Again, it's not clear to me how much groundwork is being done to look at how we can scale up these projects. And we will need the data to be in place before we can scale up the projects. And even when all of this groundwork has been done, it will take time for a market for these financial investments to develop. It's not realistic to expect to be able to raise £10 to £15 billion over the course of a few months. So, Presiding Officer, if the 2030 targets are to be feasible at all, the urgent question is what is being done to progress this essential work and who is going to take this forward? Now, we know it can't be local authorities. They have told the committee that they don't have the capacity, the requisite skills or the expertise to deliver these targets. And we know it won't be the Scottish National Investment Bank. The reality is that this work can only be led and progressed by the Scottish Government. Now, I had a constructive exchange with the Cabinet Secretary at committee on this question, and I believe his position is that most of this work will be undertaken by the new National Energy Agency. But I continue to have concerns that this won't nearly be enough to address the challenges I have outlined. This new body will be a virtual agency with no additional resource, no additional budget and no additional staff. And it is only going to become operational by 2025, the year when the physical work will have to start. Given all of these challenges I've highlighted to the committee, I have to tell the Cabinet Secretary that as things stand, it is hard to see how the 2030 targets to decarbonise heat and buildings will be met. And I look forward in his remarks to perhaps addressing some of the concerns I have raised. Presiding Officer, let me briefly highlight two further areas of challenge in terms of delivery that the committee has taken evidence on. In the transport sector, the rollout of public EV charging points will be vital in reducing emissions. But again, this is another area in which we are falling behind targets. The UK Climate Change Committee has said that we need 30,000 public charging points by 2030. We currently only have around 2,100, which means that we need to be installing around 4,000 a year between now and 2030. We are currently not anywhere close to that rate. And again, while local authorities are the delivery agents, they need much more help from the Scottish Government in order to reach this target, to achieve economies of scale and ensure there is consistent technology used throughout Scotland. Yes, I'd be happy to.
Liam MacArthur.
Dean Lockhart, I'm very interested in the points that he set out. In terms of the charging network, would he agree it's not just a numbers game, it's about getting the right chargers in the right place and also making sure that the ongoing maintenance of those charge points is kept up in order to secure the public confidence that we need to see for that transition to happen?
Dean Lockhart.
Yes, I absolutely agree with what Liam MacArthur has said. I think it's about consistency of technology as well, making sure that the same charging points have the same, using the same technology across all 32 local authorities. And it's about economies of scale. You know, there's no point in individual local authorities procuring different charging points at a higher cost when it can hopefully be done on a national basis and save some costs. And perhaps that has been done. I'll leave that to the Cabinet Secretary to inform us. Presiding Officer, I'll wrap up on the third and final area of challenge that we need to address, and it's the significant skills and expertise gap we face across the public and private sectors. I don't have time to present the detailed evidence given to committee on this, but it has been raised throughout the sessions. One of the Scottish Government's key policies to address the skills gap is the Green Jobs Workforce Academy, but the committee has heard evidence that this is effectively just a website which aggregates existing information and is not, frankly, in any sense a skills academy as one would expect one to be. Cabinet Secretary, it is, I have to say, policies like these that have caused the UK Climate Change Commission to call into question the credibility of the Scottish Climate Change Framework. That's their words, not mine. So let me conclude, Presiding Officer, by requesting that we need to see much more robust measures to be taken across the areas of challenge I've highlighted, and I look forward to the Cabinet Secretary's response. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Finlay Carson to speak on behalf of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I welcome the opportunity to contribute to this important debate. And I too thank my committee clerks and Spice for their support in the work we undertook on this topic. To coincide with COP26, the Rural Affairs, Island and Natural Environment Committee held a series of evidence sessions on the climate and nature emergencies, and I want to use my time today to highlight some of the points from that evidence. In particular, I want to explore the idea of a just transition and a full systems approach to finding policy solutions to these challenges. These solutions which emphasise the importance of understanding the structure and relationships between different parts of the environment. In Scotland, our wealth of natural assets can often mask the underlying biodiversity loss happening right under our noses. Scotland's marine environment is one of the greatest assets, rich in animal and plant life. and witnesses to the committee, however, outlined the impact climate change is having on fishing stocks, notably the increasing temperatures that are encouraging species to move further north or into deeper waters. And while witnesses emphasise that fisheries management over the last 20 years has resulted in recovery in many native species, cod being the notable exception, these changes in temperature have impacted growth rates in juvenile fish stocks. And these reduce yields because people have to catch more of these smaller fish in order to make up their quota, taking more fish out of the ecosystem. What this tells us is that we need proper data to drive decision-making when it comes to fisheries and environmental management to ensure we are aligning policy to meet the challenges of a changing marine environment. Aquaculture is a significant contributor to a rural economy, providing jobs in some of Scotland's most remote communities, but we also need to balance environmental interests. Everyone will be aware of the independent review of how fish farms are regulated, and the committee will consider their findings in due course. It's clear that we need to support these industries to transition responsibly. This is a sentiment echoed by many of the farmers we spoke to, and as custodians of the land, many farmers understand far better than most of us the need to transition to more sustainable farming practices. Indeed, many have been doing this for quite some time. And in evidence, the nature-friendly farming network welcomed policies that supported wildlife and climate-friendly farming and nature-based solutions, but also emphasised the need for a full system approach, which includes more constructive engagement with the private sector. This is a perspective shared by many stakeholders who have engaged with the committee's inquiry on the Good Food Nation Bill, and they emphasise the interconnected nature of the food system. This all points to a worrying picture, but the committee members have been heartened by the range of work already being carried out in Scotland to reverse some of the trends. So the Sea Wilding project based in Craignish is one example, and the community-led project is working to reverse trends in biodiversity loss by reintroducing or bolstering key species like oysters and seagrass. Importantly, the Sea Wilding project uses a range of low-cost methods which it believes could easily be replicated across communities, and I would like to see more done to help these kind of initiatives so they can be copied across Scotland. The Sea Wilding project exemplifies the need for us all to be better custodians of the natural environment. And this is something reflected in the evidence we heard from SEPA, which emphasised the need to move away from a mass transaction approach whereby regulators simply encourage polluters to improve their environmental performance to this full system approach. SEPA gave an example of regulation of the whisky sector and barley growers. So rather than dealing with individual businesses, SEPA instead look at the wider challenges facing rural communities with respect to climate change, one being water scarcity. And they also adopt a more holistic approach, sitting down with the whisky industry, barley growers and others, to ask just how they can help reduce water use in their supply chain. And this full system approach aids regulators, producers and communities in tackling the multiple challenges simultaneously while making domestic production more resilient. This again speaks to the need for a more integrated and holistic approach to policy making, which adds and adequately values natural assets in a sustainable way, something which is well defined through the notion of a natural capital. And the committee had the pleasure of speaking with Professor Dieter Helm from Oxford University, an expert in this area, and he's described why natural capital is a helpful way of thinking about the great environmental challenges we face, as it forces us to see the environment as a key input into the economy, ending the tension between economic growth and protecting and enhancing environment. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, Scotland is not immune from the impact of climate change, but some good work has already been done to mitigate these effects. Scotland has its part to play in addressing these challenges globally, and key industries need to be supported to a just transition, and policymakers need to take a full system approach in finding policy solutions to these challenges. This strongly links to the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee's remit and the significant developments post-EU exit for fisheries and agricultural policy. The Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands told us last week about the Fisheries Marine Strategy under development, and agriculture reform is due in 2023. Together, these offer us an unprecedented opportunity to reconsider our relationship with the natural environment and how we use and benefit from them, and the committee looks forward to scrutinising these policies over the course of the session. Thank you to the Net Zero Energy and Tourism Committee for holding, Transport Committee for holding this important debate and giving me, as the Rural Affairs and Islands and Natural Environment Convener, the opportunity to set out our priorities within this important issue.
Thank you. I now call on Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer, and can I welcome the committee bringing forward this debate on the road to COP27 following the COP26 taking place in Glasgow last year. President Officer, tackling the climate crisis is the most urgent issue of our time. COP26 was not only one of the largest events ever held in Scotland, but also one of the most important. We can, of course, be proud of the contribution that Scotland made towards its successful outcome. The summit concluded with the adoption of the Glasgow Climate Pact, seeing countries commit to increased ambition and action. The pact means capping temperatures increases at 1.5 degrees is no longer questioned. Action on adaptation and finance is agreed as being critical. And for the first time, there are to be discussions on helping developing countries pay for loss and damage. Now, while the pact represents progress on many important issues and provides a basis for further action, we know it didn't deliver all of the asks that every country called for. To keep 1.5 degrees alive, the commitments made at COP26 must be delivered, and COP27 must see progress on these aims. Issues of fairness and equity were at the forefront of discussions during COP26, and it was recognised that more is required to adapt to an already changing climate and progress the loss and damage agenda. We can be proud of the significant progress that Scotland has made in decarbonising the economy while strengthening it. In our 2019 data, it shows that we have reduced our emissions by some 51.5% on the 1990 baseline figures. We have decarbonised faster than any other country in the G20 since 2008. And, for example, the quantity of renewable energy produced in Scotland in 2020 was equivalent to 98% of our gross electricity consumption. As recently as 2010, that figure stood at only 50%. I'm proud of this progress and the level of ambition which we have set out, but clearly we must go further to meet our highly ambitious targets, and have no doubt that challenges lie ahead. It took 30 years to halve our emissions, and we need to do the same again over the next 9 years alone. Last year, we finalised the updated climate change plan, which included commitments to invest at least £1.8 billion over this Parliament to decarbonise heat, and £250 million package to restore 250,000 hectares of degraded peatland by 2030. We continue to raise our ambitions. During COP, we published our Hydrogen Action Plan, backed by more than £100 million of funding, and announced a new £55 million multi-year commitment to the Nature Restoration Fund to transform, protect and drive forward nature's recovery. Since COP26, we have published a roadmap on our commitment to reduce car kilometres by 20% by 2030. And as of the 31st of January this year, all under 22s resident in Scotland have access to free bus travel. I also noted with interest the recent survey which was published by Renewables UK, which shows that Scots overwhelmingly support political parties that support renewable power generation, aligning with our own research indicating public backing for wind energy is at a record high. Furthermore, take a brief intervention from the member, and I have to make progress.
Liam Kerr.
Of course, I will be brief. The public also appear to support nuclear generation in Scotland. Does the minister concede that?
I do recognise that there are those some people in Scotland who do support it, but of course we are committed to making sure that we deliver on renewables, which is a much cheaper form of electricity and helps to reduce bills, unlike nuclear power. Can I also say, Signed Officer, furthermore, in response to Russia's horrifying and appalling invasion of Ukraine, the European Commission has outlined plans to enable independence from Russian gas. It proposes to speed up the renewable rollout, improve energy efficiency and replace gas in heating and power, with the aim to reduce demand for Russian gas by two-thirds before the end of this year. The Executive Vice President of the European Green Deal, Frans Timmermans, highlighted that renewables are the cheap, clean and potentially endless source of energy, and instead of funding fossil fuel industry elsewhere, they create jobs here. The Commission's views on fossil fuels chime with their own, rejecting unlimited extraction. Scotland's energy sector can be a key part of a solution that seeks to ensure energy security amid ongoing economic and geopolitical turbulence. Our focus is on achieving the fastest possible just transition for the oil and gas sector. And we are currently updating our energy strategy and our just transition plan, setting out how we can make sure that the economic and social impacts of the energy transition are being managed. General Officer, of course, the commitments do not stop at our borders. Scotland led, by example, COP26 by becoming the first developed country in the world to support countries experiencing loss and damage through the world's first climate justice fund, and we intend to build on that in the years to come. And drawing my remarks to a close, Presiding Officer, as we move towards COP27, we are establishing a COP27 programme that builds on our achievements from COP26 and ensures that we play our part in delivering the Glasgow Climate Pact and to attract investment and jobs as part of the transition here in Scotland.
Thank you. I now call on Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am very pleased to speak in this committee debate about COP26 and taking it to COP27. And you know, for all our different views and our different routes to possible solutions, the Net Zero Committee is, in my view, a very effective committee. It's one which adopts an informed and in-depth approach and whose members are prepared to listen to each other's points of view. On the road to COP27, I think that evidence-based collaborative working will be very important, which is the theme I shall return to shortly. And as the Cabinet Secretary said, COP26 did indeed set us on that road. It kept the goal of limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees alive. It sounded the death knell for coal power, alongside a pledge to cut methane emissions by 30% by 2030. More than 100 countries signed a pledge to reverse deforestation. And the UK, the second highest performing country in the Climate Change Performance Index, sets the example. Remember, between 1990 and 2019, whilst UK emissions decreased by 44%, the fastest in the G7, we grew the economy by 78%, showing this can be done. The UK is the largest producer of offshore wind energy in the world, and the UK has doubled our international climate finance to help developing nations. But the Cabinet Secretary was right. Again, we must do more. And that means substance, not sound bites. So when Mark Ruskell writes in Saturday's Herald that renewables can replace oil and gas, he's surely got to back that up with a firm, evidence-based answer as to the question, when? Now, just 2 days ago, I asked the Cabinet Secretary what year he projected his ramped-up renewables would ensure we had no further need for oil and gas. He didn't even attempt to answer that. Instead, he resorted to weasel words, as he did just now, saying the equivalent of Scotland's domestic electricity supply, some 98% of it, now comes from renewable sources. Now, of course, the reality is that in 2020, 56% of the electricity consumed in Scotland came from renewable sources. My point is this: if we are to have any chance, we have to deal in reality, not spin. Yes, I will.
Mark Ruskell.
Thank the member for giving way on that point. Does he not recognise, though, that there is a commitment from the Scottish Government to look at that question about what our energy needs are, about how quickly we can make the transition away from oil and gas, and how quickly we can deploy renewables to replace that? It's not an easy answer to easy question to answer, but it is being done. Government is doing that work.
Liam Kerr.
Well, I recognise the commitment, but the point I'm making, Mr Ruskell, is that a government that hides behind selective data, patting itself on the back for mediocrity, gives false confidence that the problem is being addressed. And what we can't have here is ministers telling people to install micro-energy generation whilst only 22% of government buildings have solar panels, or telling people to cut their energy usage, then spending more than £4 million of public money on energy-guzzling electronic billboards, or telling us all to drive electric vehicles, while less than a fifth of public bodies' vehicles are zero emission. And doing more means moving away from silo thinking, which means not implementing a car park tax to force us onto public transport, then cutting 250 rail services and presiding over a £640 million black hole in funding for decarbonising buses. It means Patrick Harvey examining his blanket opposition to road building whilst willfully ignoring a report showing lorries on single carriageway trunk roads emit nearly 2 tonnes more CO2 every day than on a dual carriageway, or telling us his solution to cutting emissions and saving the planet is banning drive-throughs, or telling the people of Aberdeen that the way to decarbonise their granite houses is to put in solid wall insulation without bothering to find out how much that actually costs or how long the disruption would last. And my second point, Presiding Officer, was illustrated by both Mark Ruskell and the Cabinet Secretary in their Herald contributions, because rather than acknowledge, for example, the UK government's contracts for different scheme in Scotland, or that thanks to being part of the UK, Scotland will get 2 free ports backed by up to £52 million of UK funding, or the UK government's £110 million investment in offshore wind manufacturing in Rosshire, alongside a huge investment into Scotland's tidal power, both pivoted to denigrating the UK, which is extraordinary when you consider that it is this government which, for example, has failed to hit their own legal emissions targets and their renewable heat target, and pushed back their flagship commitment to ban biodegradable landfill waste. And it's that desperation for deflection that risks potholes on the road to COP27.
The member is about to conclude. Thank you.
It is a facile and simplistic approach to policymaking, which owes more to fomenting grievance and division than it does to seriously confronting the very real climate emergency. Presiding Officer, if we truly want to proceed on the road to COP27, we must travel it together. The Scottish Government must look to our committee and observe how those with fundamentally different views work productively together. So let's have less spin, fewer soundbites, more substance, and much more collaborative, collegiate working between Scotland's two governments. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on Colin Smith. Up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's over 100 days since Scotland welcomed the world to COP26. But, Presiding Officer, the generation-defining decisions made barely keep alive the goal agreed in Paris a decade ago of limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees. The task of Glasgow was to set out credible plans for delivering a 50% cut in global emissions by 2030. And whilst the summit made modest progress, it was largely a missed opportunity. Climate delay when we really needed climate delivery. The commitments from Glasgow for 2030, even if implemented, represent less than 25% of the ambition required. Rather than that, the destructive but manageable 1.5 degrees, they have still put us on track for a devastating 2.4 degrees. That's why, according to the UN Secretary General, the goal of 1.5 degrees is on life support. The job of all governments, including our own two, is to deliver intensive care. That starts by being honest about what happened in Glasgow. There were some positives, but COP26 was spin over substance. Too much praise of inadequate net zero plans. Minor commitments described as transformational by the Prime Minister. That emboldened the big emitters who clubbed together to gut the main deal's wording on coal. And there's still no sign of the overdue $100 billion in climate finance being delivered, with developing countries still having to argue for it at COP26 10 years after it was agreed. That's damaged the trust and broken the coalition between the most vulnerable developing countries and developed countries that was the foundation of the landmark Paris Agreement in 2015 and maximised pressure at that time on the world's big emitters. It's tragic we did not see a repeat in Glasgow. So the question now is, what's going to be different in the next year in the run-up to COP27? As president of COP26, the UK government needs to lead on urgently rebuilding the Paris Climate Coalition and with it trust with the developing world. We need to call out the big hitters far more. And at home, we need to stop just talking about a just transition and start delivering one. Take transport. It's still the largest source of greenhouse gas emissions in Scotland, responsible for more than a third. Yet the Scottish Government have just hiked up rail fares by record levels, are pressing ahead with cuts to ticket offices and are axing 90,000 train services a year. And we're still waiting for the Government to give councils the powers to run their own local bus services that are secured in the Transport Bill over 2 years ago, never mind the smart ticketing promised over a decade ago. And Glasgow delegates going to COP benefited from that smart integrated ticketing, but not commuters going to their work during the day. It's not good enough that the people of Scotland can't have smart ticketing when we can deliver it for international visitors. In 2012, the First Minister promised Scotland the Saltire card. 10 years on, all the government has delivered is a consultation and setting up a committee. When more than ever, Scotland needs Oyster card-style ticketing to make it cheaper, quicker and easier for commuters on buses, on trains, trams, subways and ferries. The government is stuck in the slow lane when it comes to smart ticketing. So today, when summing up, I hope that the Minister will name the date when Scotland's commuters will stop being left behind the rest of the world and actually have a single national smart card. They've had 10 years to think about it, and I don't know, Presiding Officer, whether I'm going to get my bus pass or my smart card first. I fear it will be the former. Presiding Officer, it's not just on public transport the government are leaving Scotland behind, it's also on green jobs. We all remember Alex Salmond promising that Scotland would be the Saudi Arabia of renewables. But a decade on from the SNP pledging 130,000 green jobs by 2020, they've delivered less than a sixth, and it's fallen. That's why, Presiding Officer, Scotland's oil and gas workers simply do not trust the government on jobs. Just weeks after a Green Minister sank plans for a publicly owned Scottish energy firm, the SNP and Green Coalition leased Scotland's seabeds on the cheap entirely to overseas-owned multinationals with questionable human... I'll take an intervention, yeah.
I have to be very brief because we don't have any time in hand. Very briefly, please, Mr Kerr.
Just on the oil and gas point, does the member not agree then, because he mentioned spin earlier on, that it is not sufficient for the Scottish Government to announce a Just Transition Fund with great fanfare without putting any substance underneath it and just letting the oil and gas workers down?
Mr Smith.
I certainly agree with that point. And I think one of the concerns that I certainly have is that on offshoring Scotland's wind, they're offshoring the profits, but the fear is they're also offshoring the jobs. So Scotland will get none of the billions in profits. We're going to get a pitiful level of rent. And what I would ask the government to do is to make sure that the money we do receive, the £700 million and possibly slightly more, is actually invested in a Scottish renewables fund to create those jobs that we need. Investing in Scottish ports, investing in skills and investing in Scottish factories, because it is bad enough that the wind is not only offshore but so too are the profits, and we can't let it also be the jobs. Because, Presiding Officer, we all recognise the need for a transition to net zero, but it has to be a jobs-led just transition. There's a lot more we could say today about the journey to net zero, but I appreciate that we're running out of time. But what I will say is that Labour will be guided by our priority in the months and years ahead, that we will call for a just transition, a green industrial revolution that leaves no worker, no family and no community behind. We need to have climate justice, but we also have to have economic justice. And only by delivering both will we have a genuine just transition to net zero, which is led by good, secure, unionised jobs for our people. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call Liam MacArthur up to 4 minutes, please, Mr MacArthur.
Thank you, President. Officer, can I start by thanking Dean Lockhart and his committee colleagues for enabling the debate? The circus has long since left town, but I think it's right that we have a cold, hard look at what was achieved at COP26 and where we go from here. And I believe, as others have suggested, that progress was made, not enough, but progress on mitigation, adaptation and on loss and damage. A welcome, if long overdue, recognition as well of the role nature and biodiversity must play in helping us keep global warming below 1.5 degrees, something I hope is reflected in the government's forthcoming biodiversity strategy and natural environment bill. Yet there's no avoiding the fact that COP26 fell short. Targets for coal down, but not out. Vital climate finance delayed again. And what Climate Action Tracker referred to as, quote, a clear credibility, action and commitment gap. Indeed, this description fits uncomfortably well Scotland's current situation. For all the talk of world-leading legislation, the Scottish Government has repeatedly missed its emissions reduction targets. 2020 may be met, but only thanks to the pandemic. On transport, accounting for a third of all emissions, progress remains stalled. We need to see the Government's loan scheme to help people move to electric vehicles expanded and repayment periods extended. We need a massive expansion of the charging network referred to by Dean Lockhart, including in residential areas, along with accelerated progress in the transition for other vehicle types. And we urgently need a ferry replacement programme that can both reduce emissions but also protect lifeline services. On heat, we've actually gone into reverse. There's much to welcome in the recently published heat strategy, but the price tag it places on households and businesses is unrealistic, even before the cost of living crisis hit. We need the government to scale up its ambition and contribution to the national retrofit programme. We need a fabric-first approach and presumption that all new builds are installed with zero or low-carbon heating systems. And for those looking to install such systems, there should be upfront vouchers rather than cash back or loans. On renewable energy, of course, the news is better, but that's not to say there aren't challenges here too. The ScotWind announcement leaves questions about how this will actually be delivered and the impact on the Scottish supply chains, the point picked up by Colin Smith. Before making final decisions on contracts, I'd urge the Cabinet Secretary to speak directly to relevant supply chains, including those in Orkney with whom I met last week. When we see wind farm jackets at Methil being built not by Scottish workers, but by workers from elsewhere in Europe, the scale of the challenge ahead is obvious. Of course, the appalling situation that is unfolding in Ukraine and the steps rightly being taken to reduce reliance on Russian gas and oil will also need to be factored into decisions going forward. We do not expect immediate answers to that, but this is inevitably going to have an impact not just on the speed of transition, but also in the shape of our energy mix in the years ahead. Presiding Officer, our efforts to achieve our interim target and net zero by 2045 continue, I think, to enjoy strong cross-party support in this Parliament. However, after years of falling behind, Scottish Ministers must spell out in much greater detail how they intend to get back on track. As the UK Climate Change Committee stated, quote, most of the key policy levers are now in the hands of the Scottish Government, but promises have not turned into action. Looking ahead to COP27, Scottish Liberal Democrats believe this mismatch between promises and action by ministers must be urgently addressed. Thank you.
Thank you. And we now move to the open debate. I would advise members there is no time in hand. Members have up to 4 minutes to make their speeches, and any interventions they choose to take must be absorbed within their speech. And I call Natalie Dawn, who is joining us remotely, to be followed by Tess White. Ms Dawn.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. COP26 was a significant point in our planet's future. However, while there was much positive progress made, we still have a long way to go. As we've already heard today, COP26 succeeded in keeping the ambition of 1.5 degrees alive, in sight, and the importance of this is no longer questioned, but it's only going to be delivered through immediate global efforts. Here in Scotland, we have some of the most ambitious climate targets anywhere in the world. One of the large-scale messages at COP26 was that countries in general must halve emissions versus 1990 levels by 2030. And that's why Scotland's legally binding 2030 emissions target of a 75% reduction is world-leading in its ambition. The Scottish budget for this year reaffirmed our commitment to these targets, providing the first £20 million of our 10-year £500 million Just Transition Fund, £336 million for energy efficiency, low carbon and renewable heat, and £60 million for large-scale heat decarbonisation projects. And this is just some of the actions that the Scottish Government are taking to meet our climate targets. I'm extremely proud of the role that Scotland played in COP26, leading the way by becoming the first developed nation to commit funding to loss and damage, and recently committing to treble the world's first climate justice fund to £36 million over this Parliament. And I want to expand on that. Scotland has committed to a climate justice approach, recognising that those least responsible for the global emergency are being affected most severely by it. Our children did not create the mountains of plastic that we see lying in villages in Indonesia. They did not poison our oceans and they did not cut down the rainforests. Likewise, it's not the countries that have been worst affected by climate change that are profiting the most from it. And now leaders of the rich, developed countries must go further. Today, I especially want to highlight the role of our young people in the climate crisis, who were not wholly satisfied with the outcomes of COP26. Young people have been truly inspirational, shown absolute determination and passion, and are arguably the most environmentally focused part of our society. If we fail them, it is young people that will bear the brunt of our inaction and incompetence. It is our generation's duty to ensure that our children have a planet to inherit. Just a few weeks ago, the NZ Committee heard from members of the Scottish Youth Parliament and the Children's Parliament, and it was so refreshing to speak to them and hear some of the things that they wanted to focus on, such as promoting active travel, sustainable green transport and a circular economy. However, it is not just about listening to young people. They absolutely must be included and be a key part of the decision-making process. Our approach to climate change will require cooperation at all levels, and at the moment I feel our young people are drastically underrepresented within a community setting, local government and national government. We need to ensure that we are welcoming and encouraging our young people to enable them to get involved. I'm therefore delighted that the £500,000 for the social enterprise fuel change will accelerate the programme's expansion, enabling more young people to contribute to developing low-carbon solutions to climate-related challenges. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, there are many challenges ahead, some of which my colleagues have highlighted today, and the work of the NZ Committee will be absolutely crucial in helping to work through these. The Scottish Government is taking action, and given some of the policies that I've outlined today, are clearly committed to meeting the targets set. But given the reserve nature of many key policy levers for decarbonisation, a more ambitious UK-wide approach will be absolutely critical in achieving our goals. While the Net Zero Strategy reaffirmed UK Government priorities, it does not go far enough in many of the areas where we have repeatedly called for action. The world's leading nations cannot procrastinate any longer. COP26 was not job done. It did not deliver as much as Global South countries, activists and campaigners rightly demanded. COP27 must see the world deliver on commitments made with urgency and energy and ensure that the promises made are met and that climate action delivers for those on the front line of the crisis.
Thank you. And I now call Tess White to be followed by Siobhan Brown.
Presiding Officer, COP26 and the Glasgow Climate Pact, negotiated and signed by almost 200 countries, underscored that climate change is an international crisis that requires an international response. It was a historic agreement, a testament to the UK presidency, and a huge step forward in keeping 1.5 degrees alive. Ahead of COP27, we're facing an international crisis of a different kind. The Russian invasion of Ukraine has provoked outrage the world over, and it has major geopolitical implications, not least for global energy supply, security and prices. This too will have a bearing on short to mid-term climate targets. The conflict will also prevent cooperation with Russia on climate change taking place, a huge emitter along with China. All of this will need to be considered carefully by the international community as Egypt assumes the mantle of the COP presidency. The reality, Presiding Officer, is that we live in an interdependent world, and the world is in a very different place to November 2021, when international representatives gathered in Glasgow. Governments must accept this, and they must respond accordingly. That's why Michael Matheson's response to legitimate questioning on energy supply and security by my colleague Liam Kerr earlier this week was so astonishing. It amounted to nothing to see and nothing has changed. No review of the Scottish Government's position on oil and gas exploration in the North Sea. No timeline for when Scotland will fully transition to renewables. Scant detail on the just transition flat-out refusal to look at nuclear energy options as part of Scotland's energy mix. An elusive energy strategy. Presiding Officer, I'm reminded of the fable of the chicken who was so busy worrying about the sky falling in that he got eaten by the fox. The SNP Green government want to turn off the taps in the North Sea, but we're years away from the transition to renewables. It will be at least 10 years before the Scottish offshore wind sector is fully up and running. Skill shortages are hampering progress, shortages that Audit Scotland has attributed directly to the Scottish Government's lack of leadership. The Climate Change Committee's latest report on Scotland's climate change plan is clear, and I quote, "Most of the key policy levers are now in the hands of the Scottish Government, but promises have not yet turned into action." Presiding Officer, what's happening 2,000 miles away must be a wake-up call. It simply isn't tenable to turn off domestic oil and gas production at this time of profound geopolitical uncertainty, when Scotland's energy mix cannot meet demand. To do so would be complete madness. It would mean becoming increasingly reliant on foreign imports, with implications for our carbon footprint and our energy security. It's madness, too, to deter investment in the North Sea with public pronouncements pandering to dogma and doctrine. At least Fergus Ewing has the gumption to disagree with the Greens. I urge Nicola Sturgeon to listen to her backbench rather than her Extinction Rebellion colleagues. But, Presiding Officer, against the background of recent events, there is recognition from both the UK and Scottish governments that we need to generate cheaper, cleaner power. The agreement on free ports, which will help to secure clean economic growth for Scotland, demonstrates what can be achieved when constitutional grievance is set to one side. So as we look to COP27, let's work together as one United Kingdom to protect the planet. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call Siobhan Brown to be followed by Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It was not long ago that Glasgow showed the world some Scottish hospitality as leaders gathered to address the climate crisis. COP26, as we've heard already, provided an opportunity to make real positive changes in global policies to keep the goal of 1.5 alive. The Glasgow Climate Pact did not go as far as many of the countries had hoped for, and it was disappointing to see that there was watering down in the last moments of the summit. However, I'm sure we can agree that some progress was made, but there is so much more to do. It is imperative that we continue to work at an international level to find solutions with other countries around the globe to find a green transition from the pandemic. This is not an easy task, and we must all step up and rise to the challenge and all do our bit, no matter how small. Every bit helps us on this journey. All elected members in this chamber have a responsibility to decide what path Scotland will take in our role against climate change, and we already do have so much to celebrate. Renewable energy makes up 97.4% of our energy source in my constituency of Ayr and has played an integral part in meeting this demand. I recently visited the Port of Ayr to see firsthand the work that they do and what plans they have for the future as we move to net zero. Currently, many of Scotland's wind turbine blades come through the port before being assembled elsewhere in Scotland. Just up the road in Troon, I was joined by the Minister for Environment and Land Reform a few weeks ago to visit Glennon Brothers Timber, another business that is thriving in my constituency. They sustainably produce timber from Scottish spruce to make Scottish homes. They then use the byproducts of this process to generate all their own heat and energy. Furthermore, the Timber Link service, supported by the Scottish Government, saw 52,500 tonnes shipped directly into Troon Harbour in 2021. This took the equivalent of 2,100 lorry movements off the road. We need to use our ports more and this fantastic timberlink initiative and remove more lorries from our roads. It is clear that climate-friendly policies can be business-friendly policies. The two are not opposed to each other. While we should recognise the work that has already been done, we must not be complacent. There is still a long journey ahead, and we need to be ambitious in order to preserve Scotland's beauty and our planet for our future generations to come. Members may have watched a recent BBC Panorama documentary that showed the extent of illegal waste dumping in Scotland. It was, to say the least, shocking. These illegal practices by criminals have a massive effect on our environment, communities and our taxpayers. I'm pleased to hear that the Justice Secretary is well aware of this and is making sure that these criminals are held accountable for their actions. Colleagues, the recycling process in Scotland is something that we do need to work on. Many everyday household items are put into recycling bins and under the well-intentioned belief that they are recyclable. However, most people are not aware that items such as crisp packets, medicine blister packs, contact lens containers, bread bags, sweetie biscuits and snack wrapping, toothpaste tubes and milk bottle tops are just to name a few that cannot be recycled. This is because they are classed too hard to recycle and are usually only taken in by specialist schemes run by committed volunteers. One of them is Betty McDonald from Prestwick, who has set up the town's Recycle Saturday initiative. Every month, Betty and a team of volunteers collect boxes full of these hard-to-recycle items, which are then sent to specialist recycling facilities. Betty is going above and beyond for her community. However, expansion of these schemes is severely limited, and if we want to properly fix this problem, we need much larger action at a higher level. We need to educate people on the items we can and we cannot recycle to stop our landfills from growing ever larger. Let me draw my remarks to a conclusion. Each and every one of us has been blessed with a country and a planet of outstanding natural beauty. We would do ourselves and our children's children a monumental disservice if we were not to protect and preserve it. This is something that goes far beyond party politics. Let's come together to work towards a just and fair transition to net zero for the benefit of Scotland and the world. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Monica Lennon to be followed by Paul McLennan. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a privilege to serve as a member of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee, and I invite colleagues and the public to tune in on a Tuesday morning and follow our debates. I don't know what I was expecting from today's debate, because I know it's a challenging one. There's so much we can say, there's so many topics to cover. And I feel like people have tried, but we have heard a few sound bites and spins, so I'm going to try really hard to avoid that, because I know that on the committee, actually, we are really collaborative, and I think there's a lot of different experience. We've got a former Cabinet Secretary, we've got former and sitting councillors, and I think we do try and leave our kind of party politics the door. And I think, to be honest, in this crisis that we face around the world in terms of climate and nature emergency, you know, none of us can afford to be proud. We have to take good ideas wherever we find them. And just yesterday, we had the youngest ever petitioner to the Scottish Parliament, who's 7 years old, who came with a brilliant idea. I think he might have met with the First Minister as well. And I think it actually put a smile on people's faces. So we should be proud that we are, an open and listening parliament. And, you know, whether you're 7 or 77, if you've got a good idea, drop a line to the Net Zero Committee clerks. I'm sure they'll thank me for saying that. But genuinely, we want to hear good ideas. And also, we want government, whether that's here in Scotland, at the Scottish Government, the UK Government, local government. We've got a big inquiry on just now looking at the role of local government in achieving net zero, and particularly looking at finance. So I was going to intervene on my colleague Liam Kerr when he was talking about the two governments. Let's not forget local government, because they're really, really important in this. And we need to hear more from our colleagues across Scotland's local authority. So that's not what I had written down at all, but that was just my reflections on what I'd heard so far. When you're on the back benches, you kind of get a bit maybe looser with your style of speeches. But I don't think any of us are under any illusion about the scale of the challenge that we face. It was a real privilege to play a very small part in COP26 and to attend with colleagues. And yes, some progress has been made, but we know not enough. And, you know, I think colleagues who were involved in the final day and deliberation of COP26 said COP27 has already started. And I think that's what we try and do in the committees. We try and look to the future. Going back to your local government, because I wanted to talk about energy. And what I was going to maybe suggest to Liam Kerr earlier on was that we do need to look more closely at what is happening in local government. And just last week, if I can check back on my notes, I read some really encouraging news from North Ayrshire Council about the plans that they have in terms of their solar farms and other renewable projects. And they're saying that between their solar and wind turbine projects, that could potentially generate 277% of North Ayrshire's future energy demand, and that would make North Ayrshire a net exporter of excess renewable energy to help decarbonise the electricity. So there's some really good innovative stuff happening out there, but what we have heard from local government during our inquiry so far is that resources is an issue. So we are looking at what other means of finance exist for local government. We all need to be open-minded on that. I also would commend the Chamber a really good report by Unison that was published during COP26 about decarbonising our public services. So we need to look at that too. When I spoke from the front bench for Scottish Labour just before COP26, I said we must take all necessary steps to secure a just transition to net zero in Scotland, ensuring that no individual, family or community is left behind. That was in our amendment that day, and I think that is a good note to end on, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Paul McLennan to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank the Net Zero Committee for bringing forward this debate today? I'm grateful because I intend to give this speech highlighting the exciting opportunities my constituency, East Lothian, has in Scotland's net zero ambitions and our journey towards a just transition. In November 21, the long-awaited COP26 climate summit in Glasgow ended, making important progress in a number of areas. The importance of capping temperatures increases at 1.5 degrees is now no longer questioned. As a nation, Scotland needs to deliver on our commitments. Now, given how significant emission rates from built environments alone are, it's clear that Scotland will struggle to reach net zero by 2045 without accelerated change. In East Lothian, I've already initiated a retrofit in East Lothian steering group. This group has already met and is liaising with East Lothian Council, local business and Scottish Government agencies looking at opportunities already. Partnership working, including Scottish Government, local business and NGOs, will help us deliver solutions tailored to meet local circumstances. As MSPs, we need to lead, not just grumble. Local authorities will be particularly important in ensuring a just transition to net zero. My constituency, East Lothian, has huge opportunities as we move towards our just transition. The former site of Cockenzie Power Station and current Torness Power Station both have unique grid connection access points. In December last year, Scottish Government Ministers approved a marine licence application for the 36 turbine Seagreen 1A offshore wind proposal brought forward by SSE and Total Energies. A decision then followed by unanimous support for the Seagreen onshore proposals at Cockenzie Power Site by East Lothian Councillors in August 21. National and local government working together to deliver the kind of change we need to see happen if we are serious about reaching net zero by 2045. This project, this Seagreen project will be capable of generating around about 5,000 gigawatt hours of renewable energy a year. To put this into context, it will be clean and sustainable electricity to power more than 1.6 million homes and save around about 1.6 million tonnes of carbon dioxide emissions annually. The Cockenzie substation can create numerous opportunities, not only in the actual construction, but also in the fabrication of the component parts. I'm already engaging with the company in this regard. Local business and people will benefit from opportunities such as the provision of plant and materials and other services such as accommodation and food for the site operatives. And again, discussions are underway in that regard. So these are opportunities for one project in East Lothian alone. One project. Next Friday, I'm hosting an East Lothian Energy meeting with the likes of Total, SSE, EDF, Scottish Power, Scottish Gas, Inchcape Offshore, along with SDS, Scottish Enterprise, Scottish Engineering, local colleges and, of course, East Lothian Council. All these companies that I've mentioned are engaging regarding projects in East Lothian. The focus of the meeting will be around about developing and maximising opportunities for sustainable long-term employment, including local apprenticeship opportunities, and we'll also be exploring supply chain development and manufacturing development. As Torness moves towards decommissioning, we need to ensure that the transition to renewable sources of energy is managed and provide opportunities for many years to come for the highly skilled workforce. A just transition must be just that. I am committed and dedicated to the work with the renewables industry, national and local government, to ensure East Lothian becomes a renewable energy hub in terms of grid connection, a highly skilled workforce, alongside a strong supply chain and manufacturing base. Innovative storage technology companies such as SunAmp and my constituency offer up other exciting new possibilities. Carbon capture and hydrogen opportunities also offer exciting opportunities in East Lothian. Scotland is already a world leader in renewables. We need to all to ensure to build on that. Presiding Officer, East Lothian is incredibly well placed to play its part in the challenges that we face as we move towards COP27. There are significant opportunities for Scotland to lead the way globally in finding solutions. East Lothian will play its part. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Mark Ruskell to be followed by Stephanie Callaghan. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Ruskell.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Well, 8 months to go till COP27, and keeping 1.5 alive has never looked more fragile. With a cost of living crisis fuelled by soaring oil and gas prices and war, it's never been more important to deliver safe, stable energy supplies and a safe climate. But what we've seen instead over these last 100 days has been a doubling down on maximum economic recovery of fossil fuels. Dependence building even further at a time when the just transition needs to accelerate. And despite investors walking away from Cambo, there's been a disastrous expansion of oil and gas licenses in the North Sea. And remember, this is happening in the face of what the International Energy Agency said before COP26, that there can be no new investments in oil, gas and coal. They have not changed their position on that fact. What we've seen, I'm really short for time, but I will take Mr. Whittle.
Very briefly.
Fine, President.
I'm very grateful for the member to take an intervention, and I do agree with him that they did say about no more oil and gas, but that was before we got to a position where we are no longer, Europe and the world are no longer wanting to take oil and gas from Russia. And as we transition towards renewable energy, we are going to still require oil and gas, and that has to be replaced somewhere. Why shouldn't it be from Scotland?
Mark Ruskell?
Well, we already have more oil and gas in the North Sea that we can afford to burn. And if you look at the response of governments across Europe, they're recognising that their dependency on oil and gas is a problem. They're not looking for other sources. They're looking to reduce their dependency on oil and gas for the sake of the climate, for the sake of energy security. What we've also seen in recent months is a rejection of a windfall tax in the UK, even though oil and gas companies in the North Sea are making £44,000 a second in profits. The very companies that have benefited from billions of tax subsidies in previous years are now looking to deepen our dependence on oil and gas, while ordinary people shiver in fuel poverty. And then, of course, we had the IPCC report last week, described as an atlas of human suffering by the Secretary General of the UN. But that is exactly where we're heading, unless we can decisively turn the corner now. And to stop the Glasgow Agreement withering away, we do need more progress on finance from the UK presidency. So far, the $100 billion fund for loss and damage that was first floated at Paris remains undelivered. And that is a real stain on all our consciences. And I hope that the first COP to be held in Africa will focus the agenda on how we can repay our debt. Now, what little time I have left, I'd like to focus on the Scottish Government. And I think there's much in the Scottish Government's climate programmes that has already put us on a faster route to net zero, pushing beyond the UK Climate Change Committee's pathways, from an ambitious heat and building strategy to reducing vehicle mileage, a surge in tree planting and wind power targets. I think the challenge now for the Scottish Government is to flesh out the detail of that delivery and financing, a point made by Dean Lockhart. But let me be clear, I agree with Monica Lennon here, there aren't any comfort zones for any government to sit in. And both the UK Climate Change Committee and our own Climate Assembly have highlighted areas for faster and more radical change, including in the areas of aviation, peatland restoration and diet change. The Climate Assembly in particular has given a mandate to the Scottish Government to go further, and ministers should grasp that. Introducing carbon food labelling, an action plan for reducing air miles, stronger support for peatland restoration and blue carbon is all needed. Presiding Officer, it's clear, though, that business as usual will lead us down a road of no return. It's the job of this Parliament to challenge governments to get on the best pathway to real zero, and I look forward to working with the NZ Committee on that mission. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Stephanie Callaghan, who is joining us remotely, to be followed by Brian Whittle. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's only 9 months until COP27, when the goals set in Glasgow will be revisited and the baton handed over to Egypt. For me, Presiding Officer, the road to COP27 requires leadership, partnership and investment, and I'll touch on each of these. Throughout COP26, Scotland led the way in amplifying the voices of our green generation. The Scottish Government was a bridge between the voiceless and decision makers. Purfoy might have left Glasgow, but Scotland is still that bridge, and we must use the respect we garnered in Glasgow to ensure commitments are delivered. Scotland was praised for our leadership in dedicating £2 million to a loss and damage fund and committing to a world first, a £36 million climate justice fund. And there are still some who ask, you know, why send money to the other side of the world when we're dealing with a cost of living crisis at home? But let us not forget the unifying message that we heard in Glasgow, because we're all in this together. From Bells Hill to Bangladesh and Uddingston to Uganda, none of us are safe until we're all safe. Climate justice, presiding officer, means acknowledging our fellow humans are just that, they're human like you and me. And leadership means setting aside arbitrary borders and acting as one planet. And that brings me on to partnership. COVID has illustrated really well the very real power of partnership, with scientists around the globe harnessing their astonishing talents to create vaccines in a previously unimaginable timeline. And this is the kind of dynamism and urgency that we need ahead of COP27. However, partnership globally must be matched by partnership locally too, and the building blocks to Scotland's climate response exist in our own communities. Our local people need to understand the causes and impacts of climate change and how they can work individually and collectively to be part of the solution. Local businesses too have much to offer. ACS building in my constituency are really climate champions, and this is shaping the fashion industry, the second biggest polluter on earth, by bringing big brands into the circular economy through resale and reuse. ACS already operate a carbon neutral business and they aim to be net zero by 2025. And their innovation, initiative and ideas convinced me that they will succeed at that. Such businesses show us a yellow brick road, if you like, to COP27. And we must learn from them, nurture them and widely share their innovation success. Partnerships are also about listening, and now more than ever, every voice is valid and every innovation transferable. As we seek to address this climate emergency together, it's critical to include our young people, those who will need to live longest with any decisions that we make. I'm looking forward to joining high school students from Uddingston and Bells Hill constituency next week for our first sustainability forum. So I'll be listening to their views, concerns and their ideas, and I know that they'll be shaping my actions in this chamber and government. Coming to investment, we must learn from history too as we transform our economy to protect our planet. Thatcherism devastated coal mining communities like Lanarkshire in the 80s and 90s, and underemployment and health inequalities still linger today. But today's Scottish Government are not repeating those mistakes, and I applaud them for working in consort with businesses and unions to invest in skilled green jobs. Presiding officer, the task ahead can feel really overwhelming, especially with the pandemic, horrors of war in Ukraine, cost of living crisis at home. And these are all pressing and urgent matters for government, but they cannot steer us off the path to COP27. The science is really clear. 2020 was Europe's hottest year on record. Australia's recorded its warmest day ever. And it's only by accelerating climate action that COP26 can be judged a success. We need leadership, partnership and investment. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call Brian Whittle, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think, in truth, it will be some time before we're in a position to fully appreciate what the implications of COP26 are for Scotland and for the transition towards a greener globe. I do think the signs are promising, though, and despite the ever-growing challenges of COVID and the inevitable geopolitical tensions, especially when we look across Europe, which always seem to play a role in such events. Countries around the world agreed deals on methane, coal and deforestation, to name but a few. But in the few minutes that I have, I want to focus on a couple of issues, the first one being education and skills. I think we on these bench are keen to see Scotland develop a position in the renewable sector that is as substantial, if not more so, than the one we have in oil and gas. And that means not only leading in technological innovation, but also in the scaling up and manufacturing of those technologies. We are yet to see that education system reflect that opportunity and need, as was highlighted by Dean Lockhart. I think the SNP and Greens are quick to talk about how many homes they want to move to heat pumps in the coming years. That not only means making the pumps themselves more affordable, but it also means dramatically increasing the number of engineers qualified to install and maintain them. And let's not forget, as Dean Lockhart said, there's 200,000 a year required to hit that target. Presiding Officer, this is an attainment gap that I think the Scottish Government are just not closing. I think the second green opportunity I'd like to highlight is food production, processing, consumption and waste. I've spoken many times that the high quality of food of our farmers produce should be making a short journey to the plates in schools, hospitals, prisons and every council canteen. It can be done. East Ayrshire are the exemplars. There are no excuses. Instead, we often import far too many, often inferior products, and we send our produce out the country to be processed, contributing to distances travelled and a significant carbon footprint. What's more, the food we waste globally contributes 4 times as much greenhouse gas than the entire global aviation industry. If it were a country, it would be the third biggest emitter of greenhouse gases after China and the USA. I will give way. Yes.
Mark Ruskell.
Thank the member for giving way on that point. I recognise he's passionate about reducing food waste, but would he also reflect on the recommendations of the UK Climate Change Committee, which is that we need a 20% reduction in meat and dairy consumption to have any chance of meeting our climate targets? It seems to be a real elephant in the room in this
Prime
debate.
Minister.
I've got to be honest with you. I think, as I'm going to come on to this, I think the way we blame our farmers for pollution pales into insignificance when you require a landmass the size of China to produce the amount of food that we waste. And I think that's something we could definitely be doing something about right now instead of listening to a noisy minority. This must be a parliament where we start to deliver if we're going to have any hope of actually reaching these targets, both for 2030 and 2045. We must give the public confidence that the changes they face are not only necessary, but thought through and practical. And yet what we've had from Government Minister Patrick Harvey is a pronouncement on the need to ban drive-through fast food outlets to reduce emissions. Aside from the carbon reductions from this being astonishingly marginal, I fail to see how making it harder to buy a McFlurry is going to encourage the public to buy into the government's plans to tackle climate change. Amid all the target setting and grand pledges on climate change, we should remember that no amount of rhetoric will actually reduce our emissions. I think if self-congratulatory statements about world-leading targets was a carbon-negative activity, I think Patrick Harvey and Michael Matheson would have already single-handedly decarbonised most of the developed world. We can have all the targets we want, but the only targets that matter are the ones with a route map to achieving them. And that, Presiding Officer, is what's lacking from all the Scottish Government crowing. Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And we will now move to the closing speeches. And I call on Mercedes Villalba to close for Scottish Labour. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Villalba.
Thank you. Today's debate has rightly focused on the further action needed to tackle the climate emergency following COP26 and as we look ahead to COP27 later this year. My colleague, Colin Smith, pointed out that we need to reduce emissions in those sectors of the economy where they remain stubbornly high, like domestic transport. We've heard from Tess White about concerns about the pace of transition away from fossil fuels. We in Labour believe that we need investment in both the production and distribution of renewable energy through the creation of an asset-owning, publicly owned energy company. And we've heard from Paul McLennan that we need MSPs who act and don't just grumble. But we also need ministers who act and who won't crumble under pressure from industry lobbying. That means working with trade unions representing workers in carbon-intensive sectors to create well-paid, secure, green jobs. I represent offshore oil and gas workers in the Northeast, so I understand the importance of delivering these well-paid and secure green jobs as part of a worker-led transition. These workers are being left in a position which sees their transferable skills go unrecognised. At great personal expense, they're often asked to duplicate skills and qualifications that they already have. The sector's major training bodies have failed to agree common standards, leading to the development of rival standards and training modules and qualifications. This market failure cannot continue to go unchallenged by government at the expense of workers. So that's why I've been working with Friends of the Earth Scotland and the RMT to push the Scottish Government to commit to supporting an offshore training passport, at least in principle. The First Minister welcomed the idea of an offshore training passport as a constructive proposal when I first raised it with her back in September. Yet despite repeated questioning and correspondence, ministers have refused to commit to supporting an offshore training passport, even in principle. They've continued to avoid responsibility to address the issue of skills transferability in the offshore energy sector, suggesting it's an issue to be resolved by industry. But this is a position which completely ignores the current market failure, which is preventing oil and gas workers transitioning into greener jobs. When I asked the Scottish Government whether it had engaged with the UK Government and other international parties on the issue of skills transferability at COP26, I was told that no specific conversations on the issue had taken place. I can't think of a better time than COP26 to have tried to make progress on an issue so vital to delivering a just transition. And in the wake of COP26, SNP MPs were given the opportunity to vote in favour of action on skills transferability for oil and gas workers in Westminster, but they abstained. The Scottish Government's warm words on the need for a just transition aren't being matched by any practical actions. Now, I was due to meet with the Green Skills Minister last week to discuss this issue. It wasn't an easy meeting to secure, yet it was postponed with just a day's notice. The postponement was apparently due to the Minister awaiting a significant update and wanting to share substantial progress. So, the Minister's here today. Would she like to share any of this progress with us?
Hang on a second. The Member is about to conclude. Member, you've got 2 seconds left. Thank you very much.
Okay, well, I'll be happy to hear from the Minister at another time. I'd also like, finally, to get a commitment to support an offshore training passport, at least in principle, Minister, because in the wake of COP26, as we head towards COP27, we have an opportunity to demonstrate Scotland's climate justice, underpinned by social and economic justice.
Thank you, Mr. Lovett, you're over your
time.
The time
for a green industrial revolution is now.
Please take your seat. Thank you. Can I now call Graeme Simpson to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives? Up to 5 minutes, please, Mr. Simpson.
I hear what you're saying, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's been a very sort of odd debate in some ways. There's no motion, there's no committee report to base it on. Even the title of the debate changed at one point. However, we do know that it's about climate change, and we've had some really good contributions from across the chamber, and I'll try to cover as many as possible. Let me start with Brian Whittle, if I may. Brian Whittle mentioned the need to upskill the workforce. He mentioned quite rightly that we don't have enough engineers to install some of the new technologies. And he spoke about something that he's really passionate about, which is food and food waste, and his belief that local is best. He's absolutely right about that. And speaking of waste, Siobhan Brown mentioned fly tipping and recycling. Really good topic to mention. I would just say to Siobhan Brown, she might want to get behind calls to have a moratorium on incinerators, something that I know Monica Lennon is passionate about. Now, COP26 should be remembered for what was actually achieved. There were some major steps forward on a basket of key climate issues. More than 100 countries signed a pledge to halt and reverse deforestation. At least 40 countries agreed to stop using coal, while leaders signed a pledge to cut methane emissions by 30% by 2030. Now, all that sounds good, but of course, Colin Smith said that's all very well, but we need to see delivery. We need to see substance over spin. And I agree with him. So while the goal of limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees is alive, it is only just alive, and it will depend on what countries around the world do, not just us. Some speakers have mentioned the transport sector, the biggest emitter of greenhouse gases. And here, I think the approach of the SNP Green government is disappointing. It is more stick than carrot. They seem to have declared war on drivers. They don't seem to want to deliver what is actually needed, which is better public transport. And I see that Minister Lorna Slater shaking her head. If she's disagreeing with that, perhaps she could bring forward the provisions in the Transport Act 2019, mentioned by Colin Smith, that would allow councils to run municipal bus services in their own patch. And that would, I think, deliver a step change in public transport, get people out of cars, which I assume Lorna Slater wants. But for some reason, there is dithering on government on that point. Now, Liam Kerr, in his excellent wide-ranging speech, spoke of the oil and gas sector. He spoke of how, if you want to end our reliance on oil and gas, you need to say how and when you will achieve that. And so far, the SNP and their partners in government have not answered that point. Tess White made exactly the same point and spoke of the folly of turning our backs on the North Sea. You'd expect her to say that, given her background. Mr Kerr also quite rightly mentioned some of the contradictions in government policy. Finlay Carson, in another excellent contribution as committee convener, spoke about agriculture, and he also mentioned aquaculture. We probably don't speak about these things often enough in this chamber. I'm going to rattle through some of the other contributions. Monica Lennon wants us all to work together. Well, that would be great, I have to say. She spoke about local government, the need to resource local government properly. It's not. She knows that as a former councillor, same as myself. We need more resources for local government. Paul McLennan, he spoke about work in his own area, rightly so. There sounds like there's some good stuff there. Mark Ruskell, my good friend Mark Ruskell, unfortunately is in denial on the oil and gas sector. Stephanie Callaghan, speaking remotely, spoke about the fashion industry and the need to reuse materials. She's quite right. I've been buying second-hand clothes all my life. But now we have apps like Depop. I would recommend it to members that a lot of young people are using. All in all, Presiding Officer, it's been a good debate, but there is a lot of work we need to do to deliver on the actions agreed at COP26.
Thank you. And I now call on Minister Lorna Slater to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Government. Up to 6 minutes, please. Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased and honoured to be closing this debate today on behalf of the Scottish Government, and thank you very much to all colleagues for their contributions. I think we can all agree, and several members, Colin Smith, Liam MacArthur, Monica Lennon, that the outcome of COP26 was not what the world needed. I remember Alok Sharma delivered his closing speech in tears. Island nation leaders devastated by the future that will see their nations submerged. Colin Smith was quite right to challenge the world to keep the dream of 1.5 alive. Liam MacArthur is right to hold the Scottish Government to account on our missed targets, as did Liam Kerr. We are concerned about this, and as recently as this October, put together a plan exactly how we plan to catch up on those targets. And the answer, which Liam Kerr asked a very sensible question, which is about how much energy do we need and where is that energy going to come from? What sources and how much can demand be reduced through insulation and other efficiency savings? And the answer will come from our updated energy strategy, which is a comprehensive review of this and will answer these questions in further detail for all of us. Natalie Dawn was quite right to emphasise that those who suffer most from climate change are the ones who have done the least to cause it. She is also absolutely right to highlight that young people have been leading the way on these matters, and I'd like to take this moment to thank all of the climate strikers, the Stop Cambo protesters, and all the young people who have powerfully made their voices heard. Keep it up. The world needs you. Thank you. Tess White will be interested in a study that came out today that shows that insulation and heat pumps can deliver UK energy security more quickly than domestic gas fields. And I encourage her to read that study. Certainly.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. I'll put the same question to the Minister that I put to our colleague Mark Russell and the Cabinet Secretary. When does she envisage that renewables will cover the demand so that we don't need oil and gas, whether imported or domestic?
Minister.
As I said just a minute ago, Mr Kerr asks a very sensible question. This question will be answered by our updated energy strategy. We need to assess this. This work is underway. I look forward as much as he does to seeing that. Tess White, as I say, would be interested in that study, but I'm slightly concerned that the member is in favour of the extinction of the human race, and I will remind her of the context. If you're against Extinction Rebellion, the context of global heating, at 6 degrees of warming, it is estimated that 95% of life on Earth will be extinct. Only a transition away from fossil fuels, urgent action to remove carbon already in the atmosphere, will save us from this fate.
Certainly. Finlay Carson.
Why Greenpeace doesn't get Scotland?
Lorna Sleek.
I'm afraid I don't. Not familiar with the incident of which the member refers. Mark Ruskell is correct that there can be no more oil and gas exploration. Our European colleagues are reacting to the situation in Ukraine and the dangers to our energy security of Russian gas by accelerating decarbonisation of their energy systems. With Siobhan Brown, I agree that climate-friendly is business-friendly. There are exciting opportunities in the circular economy, reducing business costs through reducing waste and recognising the value of materials that we currently throw away. Certainly.
Liam Kerr.
I'm genuinely grateful to the Minister for taking another intervention. Last month it was announced that the Treasury would review the Solvency II regime into low-carbon infrastructure investments following Brexit. Does the Minister welcome that review?
Minister.
I'm afraid I don't have an answer to that question right now. I'm not familiar with that particular view. I'm going to press on. I think, and both Siobhan Brown and Stephanie Callaghan will be excited to hear about my work and our work in the Scottish Government on the Extended Producer Responsibility Scheme. I have been corresponding with the UK on this week, working towards a scheme which would incentivise producers to use more easily recyclable materials in their packaging, as well as get them to contribute financially to the reduction of waste. This is a significant initiative that we'll see coming through in the next few years. Monica Lennon and Paul McLennan, I'm very keen to support local government, particularly in implementing circular economy measures, and I'm excited to hear from both of them about the local energy projects and in energy generation and storage. Just as a concern about running out of time, I'm going to jump ahead to Ms. Vialba's point. I thank Ms. Vialba for the point, and I agree with her on this very important issue. I am very sorry that I delayed our meeting. It is because there is work being done in this area by OPITO, who I did meet with, although not during COP when I was very busy, also had COVID. And the reason I delayed our meeting is because this month I'm expecting a report from OPITO on with significant progress on towards an offshore passport. So I want to meet with the member to, that's not the language that they're using, but to a communication of standards to allow the transferability of workers. I will, as soon as I have that report, share that with the member so that we can discuss it together and she can see whether she's satisfied with the progress. I think I'm out of time, I'm very sorry. I'll just jump ahead to my final remarks then. The Scottish Government will continue our focus on delivery of our ambitious climate policies, from implementing our recently published Hydrogen Action Plan to updating our energy strategies. All of our policies will carry the theme of a fair and just transition, while also looking ahead to the next full climate change plan, which we have committed to bring forward a draft to in the first half of this Parliament. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call on Fiona Hislop to wind up the debate on behalf of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee.
Presiding Officer, this was a bit of a mixed debate. It went from the global to the very local. We heard that COP26 saw imperfect progress, as Colin Smith set out. Success was not a foregone conclusion, but positive steps were taken. Science was firmly placed on the agenda, and many countries agreed plurilateral initiatives to accelerate action on coal, methane reduction, stopping fossil fuel finance, stopping deforestation, and phasing out vehicles with internal combustion engines. For the first time, as Liam MacArthur pointed out, the final text at COP26 recognised nature's critical role in tackling the climate emergency and the joint crisis of climate and biodiversity. And while this is all welcome, focus must now be given to delivery and implementation. As Melina Mera stated in the committee's post-COP26 evidence session on the 16th of November, the 2 weeks saw a barrage of pledges and pacts being made to address the nature and climate emergencies. They are welcome, but they will remain paper tigers unless parliaments, such as the Scottish Parliament, enact laws to bring them into the purview of national legislation. To paraphrase Professor Jim Skea to our committee, this Parliament has agreed on world-beating targets, and now we need world-beating action to deliver on this. The focus now must be on implementation and delivery. And opposition members like Liam Kerr are right to challenge, but they must do so constructively. Opposition, as well as government, must stretch themselves out of any comfort zone when it comes to the climate emergency. And Monica Lennon is right to stress the expectation of the public for cooperation in this place to deliver and with local government. And Paul McLennan spoke of MSPs all needing to lead. So Scotland can and must lead by example, by sharing our knowledge and expertise, our successes, as well as our failures. No government in the world has done enough, and time is not on our side. The climate emergency has begun, the world is already burning, flooding, and humanity is on red alert. During COP26, I met Marinel Ubu, a youth climate justice advocate from the Philippines. In this chamber, in November, in a debate on the conclusions of the Glasgow Climate Dialogues Communique, I spoke about Marinel's harrowing experience of Super Typhoon Haiyan in 2013, where she sadly lost relatives and friends and was left without food or water. Only weeks after COP26, another devastating Super Typhoon Rai hit the Philippines. Marinel emailed me saying, "From the communities to the national level, we are crying for funding for loss and damage, and this typhoon just showed how urgent it is already for our global leaders to already put loss and damage on the priority agenda." So, Presiding Officer, climate change is here, climate change is now. And Natalie Dawn referenced Scotland's trebling of its World First Climate Justice Fund to £36 million, with £2 million for loss and damage. And UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres said at COP26, "Scotland is one of the first international actors that has determined money for loss and damage. That is a very important point for developing countries, and so I would like to say how much I appreciate Scottish effort in this regard." So loss and damage is expected to be a COP27 focus, and it must be, as the Cabinet Secretary told us. Climate change funding needs improved. The $100 billion target was set 10 years ago and has not been delivered to the Global South, as Mark Ruskell stated, and the majority of funding that is coming through is in the form of loans. COP26 saw a last-minute washing down of the language on the coal pledge when India backed China to change the pledge from phasing out of unabated coal to phase down. And this saw India being widely blamed. But as Melina Mera made evident to our committee's post-COP session, many failed to see the inequality in this by placing intense pressure on countries like India who have not had the benefits of oil and gas to reduce their reliance on coal. And it's not fair, equal or just. And it was made clear from almost all the expert witnesses to our committee that India was being more nuanced by trying to achieve equity with the language change. It was a way to try and encourage support from developed countries who are largely responsible for the climate emergency. On private finance, COP26 saw a mobilisation of £95 trillion announced by Mark Carney, who chairs the Glasgow Financial Alliance for Net Zero, which gathers 450 organisations controlling 40% of global assets. Now, there can be no place for false offsets and double accounting. We don't just want assurance of reductions in emissions. We must see and know it is actually taking place, so global reporting standards are key. Tackling the climate emergency will hurt. It will be uncomfortable, but it must be a whole system, whole world, whole sector response. And Finlay Carson focused on the whole full system approach needed in what I thought was an exemplar speech for a convener. The dial of the world's systems must shift permanently, or there will be no clear sight for the future of and permanency of humanity in many parts of the world. The impatience and passion of the climate change activists on the streets of Glasgow reflected that. So the frustrations around COP26 were played out as a heightened focus and urgency for COP27 in Egypt later this year. As UN Secretary General said in his closing speech in Glasgow, COP27 starts now. Now, John Kerry launched the US-Egypt Climate Working Groups when he visited Egypt ahead of COP27. And I think it's probably quite, he visited there in February, and I think it's quite pertinent that the convener of the committee and both myself are quoting John Kerry rather than the current COP president, Alex Schammer. But John Kerry said in February, he asked, will we live up to our most basic responsibility to leave behind a world better than we found it? The jury is still out on that, and we have yet to provide the concrete evidence that we will. But we have to look to COP27 with hope and with determination. And, Presiding Officer, the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee will ensure that this Parliament keeps the climate emergency firmly at the top of the agenda.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on the road to COP27 and beyond, tackling the climate emergency in the aftermath of COP26. We'll now move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of motion 3390 on withdrawal of bill, UK withdrawal from the European Union Legal Continuity Scotland Bill. And I call on Angus Robertson to move the motion.
Moved formally, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The question on this motion will be put at decision time, and there is one question to be put as a result of today's business, and that question is that motion 3390, in the name of Angus Robertson, on withdrawal of Bill, UK withdrawal from the European Union Legal Continuity Scotland Bill, be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. That concludes decision time, and I close this meeting.